تفضل.
I'd like to thank the health outreach program today for giving us the opportunity to connect with our nursing colleagues in Gaza and Sudan to discuss issues related to chemotherapy administration and the complications that are associated with the administration of chemotherapy. This is a great opportunity for us as healthcare providers to be able to be in touch with other nurses and other parts of the world or other parts of the Arab world. This has been a really very effective session today, and we hope that we are going to conduct more sessions in the future to share expertise and to share knowledge and information aimed at improving our patient care. السلام عليكم. أنا حسن زهر الدين. I am the education coordinator for oncology and hematology and stem cell transplant at King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center in Riyadh. Here with me I have also Mr. Muhammad Al-Asi. He's also the clinical instructor of oncology medical nursing and palliative care program. And we also have Ms. Julie Stensness with us. She's the clinical instructor in the adult hematology and stem cell transplant area.
Welcome, مرحبا.
أنا اسمي أسعد الرئيس، مدير مركز الصحة الإلكترونية بمستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي. وإن شاء الله كلنا جلسة معكم خاصة مع غزة إن شاء الله الشفاء، عشان نعطيكم بإذن الله رؤية أوسع والأشياء اللي ممكن احنا نلبيها لكم من ندوات ومؤتمرات وبث مباشر للأنشطة العلمية حتى المؤتمرات مستشفى الملك فيصل تخصصي لكم إن شاء الله، وحأرسل لكم بإذن الله قائمة المؤتمرات والندوات وورش العمل بإذن الله لكم بإذن الله قريب إن شاء الله. تفضل.
بارك الله، شكرا أستاذ أسعد، بارك الله فيك.
الله يحييك.
Okay, due to time limitation we prefer to go straight to to our sessions. Just before we get started, are you okay all to speak English for these sessions? Are you all okay with this?
It's okay.
Yes.
كبر بالله الشاشة تبعتهم.
Okay. So okay, so we're just going to set up the screen for you. Okay, so we have our sessions today. We are going to be talking about the chemotherapy administration skill. This is a program that we hold here, and it's a two-day program. So what we are trying to focus on in this session is to look only at the particular skills that are involved in the administration of chemotherapy. This program is mainly targeted for nurses who are involved in the administration of chemotherapy agents. Earlier sent the objectives and the program for today, so I hope you all had a copy of this program. Today's objectives will be to explore the rationale for safe handling of chemotherapy, so we'll be talking a little bit about this. We'll also will be looking at the safety measures that are associated with chemo agents, handling chemo agents, contaminated body fluids, and waste disposal. We're also going to look at the process associated with chemotherapy ordering and chemotherapy administration. I've sent through our health outreach department the American Society of Clinical Oncology and Oncology Nursing Society's guideline for administration of chemotherapy, so I hope you have a copy of that. And we also will be looking at identifying the risk factor, clinical manifestation, and management of extravasation. In the program that I sent earlier for today, we're going to spend 20 minutes talking about the safe handling and waste management. Then Julie is going to do a simulation on the administration of chemotherapy. Now for the break time, I hope that we could skip the break because of the time limitation and because we've already started late. But then Mr. Muhammad will be demonstrating to you the management of spill. And last, we will be talking about extravasation, and then we also will do an extravasation management in simulation as well. So to begin our first session on chemotherapy safe handling and waste management, objectives for these sessions are actually two. We're going to look at the different characteristics of chemotherapy, and we're going to illustrate the different risk factors for exposure and how to prevent exposure to chemotherapeutic agents. So the first question that comes to anyone's mind is, why safe handling? Why do we need to safe handle chemotherapy? Can I ask for your thoughts on this? Why do you think we need to safe handle chemotherapy? That's the also down. Why do you think we need to safe handle?
For Sudan. Not for us.
Okay. Gaza or Sudan? Anyone?
Yes, of course.
Why actually, do we need yes, safe handle?
Yes, from Gaza. Chemotherapy is considered very hazardous materials, can affect the genes, teratogenic on the body. It can cause some damage to the tissue of the, we can acquisition of the chemotherapy hazards by three ways, by ingestion, by touch, by inhalation. So it's hazardous anyway. So we are concerned to take measures to save ourselves and the environment around.
Excellent. This is an excellent answer. I just want to take you back to the Occupational Safety and Health Administration's statement on the hazardous drugs, which chemotherapy is considered one of them. Hazardous drugs are capable of causing toxicity to personnel and to others who come in contact with them, and even low levels of exposure may be hazardous. So, here, the meaning of even low levels, if you remember those who works in radiation therapy, they wear the odometer to manage or to at least to monitor the levels of exposure. When it comes to working with chemotherapy, there's no way of measuring the levels of exposure, and therefore the statement here that even low levels of exposure may be hazardous. So it could be maybe one time, two times, just enough to cause damage or to cause symptoms related to toxicity. Now, why do we need to do safe handling? If we look at the characteristics of hazardous drugs that deem them dangerous to healthcare providers, first of all, they are carcinogenic, so they have the ability to cause cancer. Although chemotherapeutic agents are used to treat cancer, but they are also many evidences in literature that actually tells us that chemotherapy is also carcinogenic.
Nitrogen master, one of them.
Sorry?
Nitrogen master was used before and it proved it is carcinogenic and it was not used nowadays because of the carcinogenesis.
Yeah. We've seen also in this in patients who were treated for cancer with chemotherapy, they came back with secondary malignancies related to the treatment as well. The second characteristic is it's mutagenic, and here we're talking about mutations in the DNA because chemotherapy can actually affect the cells and can cause mutations in the DNA that could lead to also to some sorts of cancers as well, or prepare for an environment for cancer to develop. It's also teratogenic, and it has the ability to cause developmental toxicity for fetus. It can cause organ toxicity to at low doses, similarly to the toxicities that we see actually in patients, and it can also cause toxicity to the genes. So here, this is similar to mutation, it can cause toxicity to some or mutations in some genes. Whenever we talk about handling of chemotherapy or chemotherapy waste, we have to look at the four routes of possible exposure. The first route is ingestion, and of course also this might be a very extreme route of exposure. Ingestion could be simply one route if someone does not really take care of the safe handling measures during the administration or during waste, contaminating other surfaces within the patient room or within the unit or the nursing station, and someone else might be also in touch with these surfaces. This could lead to the ingestion route of chemotherapeutic agents. So strict coherence to safe handling measures and wearing of the personal protective equipment is necessary to avoid this kind of exposure. The second route of exposure is through inhalation. This is through the aerosolization of drug. We see this mainly during the preparation of chemotherapy. Absorption, this is the direct contact with the skin or with the mucous membranes, whether it's direct contact with the chemo agents or with the other contaminated items or waste or body fluids. The last route of possible exposure is through injection, and this is through accidental needle stick injuries. So whenever we need to handle chemotherapy, we need to think about those possible four routes of exposure. Here I just put in some examples on the possible risk factors. Of course, there might be some other risk factors that are associated with the procedure of giving the chemo or disposing of the waste, but these are the most common ones. I just wanted to put them here just to give you some examples on what could be situations where someone could have an exposure. During drug preparation administration, you are in direct contact with the agents. Of course, expelling air from a drug-filled syringe is a complete no-no here, so we never should attempt to be expelling any air from any syringe that is filled with drug. And of course, during change of IV tubings, priming IV tubings with chemotherapy, that's why the hospital or your organization policy should be very clear on the procedure for priming IV tubings with normal saline or with any compatible solution rather than chemotherapy. Accidental puncture of the systems, leaking connections when you handle body fluids or when you're handling waste. At any point in time when you are in dealing with these kind of situations, personnel are at risk for exposure. Now, before I continue talking about the risks here, I just want to make sure so that no one gets afraid in dealing with chemotherapy, and we end up after this session that no one wants to work in oncology and no one wants to give chemotherapy to their patient. I just want to just this statement from the Oncology Nursing Society is that meticulous attention to the use of the personal protective equipment could prevent the exposure and consequently would prevent the development of acute signs of exposure to hazardous drugs. So it means that although these drugs are dangerous, although they present lots of risks, but paying attention to safe handling measures and wearing the right equipment is actually going to prevent those complications from occurring. Now, our hospital policy here states that any patient who is on chemotherapy or is starting chemotherapy should be on chemotherapy precautions for 48 hours after the last dose is finished. This is also one of the Oncology Nursing Society's recommendation as well, even with their new guidelines in 2009. Here also you have a list in front of you for some drugs that can stay in the body fluids for more than 48 hours. Here we only are strict with the 48 hours. We don't go beyond the 48 hours. Most of the drug metabolites are excreted within the first 48 hours, and that's why we think that we are on the safe handling, within the good safe handling guidelines. Some institutions They would like to follow the safe handling timing for depending on the drug to be given. So that depends on your institution, depends on your policies and procedure with regard to that. These are some of the chemotherapy protective equipments, and you will see some of them during some of the demonstrations today. The most important two pieces of equipment that are highlighted in red here are the chemotherapy gloves and chemotherapy gowns. And I'm not sure what kind of equipments do you have at your facilities, but these are the ones that you see in the pictures are the ones that we have here. They are from Kindle, and they are made specially for chemotherapy. The gown is made of an impervious material, so it's leak-proof. So even if someone gets exposed, nothing is going to penetrate the gown. The gloves are also made of a tested material to prevent penetration of chemotherapy. Of course, there are other PPEs that needs to be addressed depending on the situation at hand. One of the things that we should always pay attention to is not only the person who is actually working with the chemo. We have also to think about those individuals who might be in contact with the patient or in contact with the waste, like housekeepers, other social workers, pharmacists, or anyone who might be in contact with the patients. And therefore, we need to make sure here that we label the patient's chart that they are on chemotherapy precaution from the period of this date and until 48 hours from this date as well. Here at our hospital, as you could see in the pictures, we have the orange bag. Orange bag are designated for chemotherapy wastes only, and this is only for non-sharp items. We have another container that is designated for chemotherapy sharps, which is separate from the regular sharp containers as well. You also see at the right side the signs that we put here on the doors that address that the patient is on chemotherapy. This is also to protect the other healthcare providers who might be entering the patient's rooms, just to alert them that they need to be careful when they encounter wastes or contaminated body fluids. For the safe handling measures as well, you need to make sure that wearing chemotherapy gown and gloves always. Those are at our facility, they are mandatory no matter what the situation is, whether you are giving chemo or whether you are handling body fluids or you are disposing wastes. You always want to wear the chemotherapy gown and the chemotherapy gloves. When it comes to body fluids, we need to make sure also when providing the urinals to male patients is that the urinals, they have a tight-fitting lid. The reason for that is that you don't want to have an accidental spills of the urine. So the lid that covers the urinals for the patient is very important item to get in oncology wards. When you're also flushing the toilet after the disposal of the body fluids in the toilet, because some of the toilets might not have lids or you don't want to contaminate the lids, we usually put an absorbent pad, and we'll show you these pads during the demonstration here. We cover the toilet with these pads and we flush the toilet twice if possible to avoid any splashing outside of the toilet bowl or any splashing on the personnel or the healthcare provider who is disposing the body fluids. So as you see in the pictures here, the yellow container at the top is the container that we use here, and this is specially made containers for chemotherapy sharps. This is not similar to the regular sharps container. This is made specially for chemotherapy. It's leak-proof, it's puncture-proof. Below you see also the orange bags. When it comes to disposal, it's important that chemotherapy is wasted in a special bags, because when you dispose the, and I'm not sure what you do at your facility, but here the disposal of wastes at outside the facility, it's incinerated at a special degrees that is different from the other other wastes. So it's very important that we isolate the chemotherapy wastes from the non-chemotherapy wastes. Here, the gown and gloves, we use double plastic chemotherapy designated bags to throw in these kind of non-sharp items. All sharps items like IV tubings, eye sharps container will go into the sharps container. This is just a picture of the spill kit, which Muhammad is going to demonstrate to you today. So we'll talk about this more. This is also what happens if you have had acute exposure. So you've done everything that you could to avoid being affected to chemo, but still you accidentally got affected either on your hand or you get exposed suddenly. This is the procedure that you should always follow when this happens, is you want to make sure that you come to the closest area where you have a faucet or water, and you want to make sure that you flush the affected area with copious amounts of water. If the affected part is your body, is part of your body which cannot be washed at the sink, then you should make sure that you head to the nearest shower and make sure that you take off all your contaminated clothes, put them in special bags, and make sure that you wash the area or you shower the area very well. You need to make sure that your supervisor or head nurse or your charge nurse is notified about this to make sure that actions are taken. You need to go to the emergency room, or sometimes you go to the family medicine clinic, whatever within your facility. And in there, they usually need to do some labs on you and just do a checkup. The labs will be just for baseline, and they usually do a CBCD and they do a liver enzymes, because they want to compare the any change in the white blood cell count later on or any elevation in the liver enzymes as well. But that does not mean that these are the only two to look for. Liver toxicities or gastric toxicities, kidney toxicities, sometimes depending on the drug that you're given, should also be evaluated. So we usually look at what drug had the healthcare provider was exposed for, and we look at what kind of side effect does this drug take. Documentation is very important. You could do an incident report. That's one of the things, just to make sure that things are followed up later on. What are the manifestations of exposure? If you look at the symptoms at the top in black, lightheadedness, nausea and vomiting, headache, alteration of mucous membrane, malaise, weakness, this one seems very common. And even if you have, we are in the winter time now, they look similar to the flu manifestations. So I wouldn't be worried that much if these are the only manifestations, but definitely something to look at. What I would be worried about is when personnel develop these kind of symptoms, which are in the black box here, like local tissue necrosis, cellulitis, or you start to lose your hair. Now, hair loss here, I'm not talking about the genetic baldness, which could occur with time. It's just sudden loss of hair after the exposure should alert you to seek medical attention immediately. Again, I just want to reiterate the statement that the use of personal protective equipment is important to prevent exposure and to prevent these kinds of manifestations as well. Here, these are some of the common reasons in literature for why staff do not use personal protective equipment, why people do not put gloves or gowns when they are handling chemotherapy or chemotherapy body fluids and waste. One of the reasons could be no time. Staff tell you, I don't have time, I'm very busy. It's too much equipment, gowns, gloves, masks, etc. I can't handle it. I am uncomfortable when I put them on. I can't do the tasks. It affects my ability to do the task. Sometimes we just simply forgot. Sometimes we say we are immune to risk. I know exactly how to handle the situation without putting any personal protective equipment. Sometimes the equipment is not available at the facility, and sometimes we are afraid of the patient's reaction. If you put on gown, gloves, goggles, head covers sometimes, or face shields, You might be afraid of the patient's reaction. You might sometimes be afraid to trigger nausea and vomiting when the patient sees the blue gown and gloves, and therefore they start to have an anticipatory nausea and vomiting. But whatever, whenever you are in a situation, you need to make sure that you do not have any of these reasons as an excuse. If the equipment is not available, you need to make sure that you discuss this with your management and to make sure that the equipment is available for you. And here we could help you out if you need literature to support this. I can personally help you out in providing this kind of evidence and this kind of literature.
Can we make some introduction or after the lecture?
Can you come again, please?
Make some comments? Can I make any introduction to you if
yes.
I ask a question now?
Sure.
Or after the lecture?
Sure, I just have one. This is the last slide, so you can ask me the question after this one.
Okay,
fair. Okay, these are one of the things for every healthcare providers. We recommend that they do annual screening. They need to do a CBCD, urine analysis, and liver function. These are mandatory at our institution that every nurse who works with chemotherapy, that they do this during their recontracting, during their annual screening. So they have to do this just to make sure that we're not missing anything during their contract year. I now have, if you have questions to ask, this is my email here. If you would like to email me, or if you have a certain issues that you would like to discuss, or if you would like some extra resources, this is my email. You can you're welcome to email me. I also included the Oncology Nursing Society's website. They have lots of resources. I really would recommend this website for you to access. They have lots of resources, lots of free items that you could download that could help you out with setting your institution's policies and procedures with regard to chemotherapy. So do you have any questions?
Okay. Me, Dr. Bayan Irsaka, I am head of hematology department in Chief Hospital. Thank you for this interesting lecture. But I have some comments. I couldn't understand in your center what is the responsibility of handling of chemotherapy. It is responsibility of the nursing view, or pharmacy can share in this handling, because in our center, the responsibility of preparing the chemotherapy, it is related to the pharmacy. It's not related to the nurse. The nurse has a little role in this issue. I couldn't understand it from your lecture. I understand that the nurse take all the responsibility in your center. So can you explain to me this?
Nurses do not prepare chemotherapy at our institution. Chemotherapy preparation is strictly pharmacy business. There are rules for chemotherapy preparation. It has to be prepared under a biologic safety cabinet of class 2 or even better. At any point in time when nurses need to give chemo, it has to be available from pharmacy for them in the form to be given. So if the drugs needs to be put, for instance, if it's oral and needs to be put in a as a solution, it has to become prepared as a solution from pharmacy. We do not do any preparations, or we do not manipulate any formulas on the unit by nurses. It's all prepared in the pharmacy.
But you said that some of the complication is the psychological aspect at the level of the patients. When see the mask and the cover head, it is necessary for the nurse to make this protection at a bedside?
Yes. They have to, at any point in time when they are giving the chemotherapy, I'm not talking about any patient contact. When you are handling body fluids, or when you are giving chemotherapy to the patients, or when you are handling the wastes, you should be putting on the chemotherapy and chemotherapy gown as the minimum requirements within that situation.
Okay.
Understood, yes.
Excuse me,
so
I'm afraid that you
if you're going just to go into the room, and just talk to the patient or shake hands with the patient, you definitely do not need to put on any of these equipments, because here you are not at risk of any body fluids or any exposure to chemotherapy.
Okay. Excuse me, but I want to tell you about your email. The slide you view us before a little minutes. I'm afraid it wasn't clear for us, so may you enlarge the slides and review it again?
Okay, let me try to do that. So. Can I get help? We need the whole slide.
We can't see it.
Okay, we're just working on it, so.
You can read it, please.
Okay. Is this okay?
No. No. Can you enlarge the slide, please?
This is the largest. This is the largest that we could do. Hold on.
Can you read it, please? Spell it. Hazard.
No. Say Hassan Zahraddin.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
No. May you read it?
Wait a moment.
Okay. You know, I can email it to Asad. I can email it to Asad, and Asad can email it to you.
Zahraddin at?
It's HZAHREDDINE.
Yeah.
At KFSHRC.edu.sa. Okay?
Okay.
I have another question.
Okay.
This is Dr. Aishan. I have French board in radiation oncology. I want to ask about the protection. With maximal protection, do you think that the chemotherapy is still have hazards like teratogenic or carcinogenic?
No. If you're looking at, and again here you have to use your discretion. And you have to make sure that the equipment that you are using is actually tested. The chemotherapy gowns, for instance, are tested for penetration with chemotherapy. The gloves that you are using are tested for penetration, but the gloves are only good for half an hour, because after half an hour, chemotherapy might be able to penetrate through the gloving. So the recommendation is that the gloves should be changed after half an hour. During the administration of chemo, or during the handling of body fluids if needed. So of course, using other equipments, like for instance, using a face shield or using an N95 mask, this will actually depends on the situation that you are handling. And you're going to see later on, when you are handling a situation like a spill management, you need to make sure that all of the kinds of PPE are put on. This includes the N95 mask, includes shoe covers, includes double gloving. So really it depends on the situation. But as I mentioned, that meticulous attention to the PPE should be governed by the institution policy and procedure. That's the responsibility of the institution, to make sure that the policies and procedures are there and they are detailed, so that the healthcare providers know exactly what kind of equipment they need to put on for each scenario. Did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Is there any need to change the person who are working in the chemotherapy preparation every few years or not?
There's no need, no. I've been working in oncology for the last 16 years, and I have here people with me. Mohammed, how long? Mohammed's been working 12 years, and Julie here with me has been working for 25 years, and you could see we are as healthy as horses.
We have a nurse, he's working for the last 30 years in our center.
Yes. So as you can see.
You know, You know, in the past, we actually don't use the safe handling of chemotherapy, and even he's worked without any protection for 15 years. And still he's okay.
Alhamdulillah.
Well, we don't want to set this as an example that it's okay to work with chemotherapy.
I do agree with you, yes, of course.
Yeah, so there are sometimes exceptions.
So okay. Let us say something. How can we explain this lecture to change our situation and to go ahead for improving our handling of chemotherapy in Gaza? Are you exposed to about our situation and how we handling the chemotherapy?
Well, I don't know at your institution what kind of facilities or equipment do you have?
Really, I am talking for some reason, because in our plan and the strategy in the future to establish an intensive care unit for chemotherapy and even for bone marrow transplant. And actually, my feelings, we are in a bad need for some training for the new generation, because nurses who is experienced in these fields, now they get old. Now they are about to be 60, to be retirement. And we need in the future to make a connection with your center to train the new generation from our nurse for some while to be exposed for the advanced technique in safety and handling of chemotherapy.
We are really happy to work with you on this. So I have my email here. We're happy to communicate in the future to talk about any programs that perhaps we can broadcast to you. We could talk maybe about just more than just a few sessions. Perhaps we could talk about a whole day simulation that we could support. We are really willing to help out as well.
Okay, thank you. Sayed will contact you. I am a head of hematology, and Sayed, he's
I can talk
you talk to him?
I'm Sayed Masri. I've working in oncology since early 1988, maybe.
MashaAllah.
The man sitting beside me, I also maybe 20 years working in the oncology department. But your lectures really renew our aches, our pains. Why? Because there is difference between science, between what we hear, what we read, and what is the fact, situation is the fact.
Correct.
There is availability sometimes of medication of chemotherapy, or very expensive chemotherapy are present in the fields to treat our patients. But we are facing deficiency in the protective measures in our hospital, especially for the nursing. We were asking our management from about 15 years ago to save us safety measures to discard our disposables. It double sacks, special containers. It's very, very difficult. We manage by ourselves. Just we discard the chemotherapeutic bags of after infusion in special bags and discard it. We ask the health keeper to withdraw it in special care. That's what is available in our hospitals. We are facing difficulties in nursing, really.
Yeah, and I really appreciate this, because even in some regions within the country here as well, we face difficulties because of budgets. Some in remote areas, especially within the kingdom, we face that the hospitals sometimes might not have these kind of budgets to cover the cost of the equipment. So sometimes there are some creative ways of creating personal protective equipment. So perhaps this is something that maybe we can discuss later on over email and see how we could maybe provide a support to you on this.
Thanks.